Hello, and welcome to this episode of Music and Machines. In our prior installment, we covered sound fundamentals, including the first machine for recording sound and music. We toured a modern LA-based recording studio with ties back to the early days of recording, and we provided biographical profiles on Thomas Edison, Jim Gordon, and Bill Putnam. In this episode, we are going on location to a city where Bill Putnam ran his groundbreaking studio operation, Universal Recording. It is a city well known for a particular style of music and for its long history as a center for manufacturing musical instruments and recording gear. We will visit a few locations specializing in vintage keyboard instruments, and we will get some insight on a component of the music production process known as mastering. Without further ado, let's get started exploring music and the machines that help make and shape it. Music and Machines is in Chicago. Chicago is one of the most musically influential cities in the world. From the blues to a history in musical instruments and recording facilities, icons like Chess Records and Universal Recording, to Hammond Organ and Shure Microphones, and even the founding location of the premier music retailing industry group, NAMM. The NAMM show might now be associated with Anaheim, California, but for most of its existence, it was hosted in Chicago at McCormick Place and the Palmer House. The Steger Building was its original operational home, and even Thomas Edison was a NAMM member. We're going to meet with some pivotal players in Chicago music, each having an important impact, and all behind the scenes. Our first stop is on Chicago's North Side to learn about a special musical instrument. The Wurlitzer electronic piano, also known as the Wurly, was a very special music machine of the 20th century. Its warm and textured sound has been used in countless R&B, jazz, and rock recordings since the 1950s. It was not the first electric piano, but it was the first to have some tangible success. And the foundation for that success came from inventor Benjamin Meisner. Wurlitzer purchased patents from Meisner and license other technologies from him to create the Wurly. Additional contributions have been attributed to Paul Renard and Howard Holman at Wurlitzer Chicago. Approximately 100,000 Wurlys were produced beginning in 1954 through the early 1980s. They were manufactured in three locations, first in Corinth, Mississippi, then in DeKalb, Illinois, and finally in Logan, Utah. Wurlitzer was a major player in pianos and organs in the late 19th and much of the 20th century, and they viewed the electric piano as a way to use innovation to sell an instrument with many desirable features to a growing population of baby boom generation kids. The Wurly was much lighter than an acoustic piano and therefore was portable. It could be used quietly with headphones, required little tuning, and had a low price point of around $300. The intended use as a student and learner piano did generate a user base, but a larger majority were weekend warriors and professional musicians using it for practicing, gigging, and recording. The end came for the Wurly in the 1980s as a victim of the growing innovation in digital keyboard instruments. The sheer multitude and variety of sounds that could then be produced on a digital keyboard far outweighed the desire for a keyboard that could do one thing. We went to the Chicago Electric Piano Company to learn more about it.
I'm Max Brink, and we're at the Chicago Electric Piano Company. And we've opened up our little floor model Wurly here, which is a teacher model from the late 1970s, the 215, which is a fun model because it has the visualizer here, which is pretty smart. Switch between sharps and flats over here, and it's overall pretty
mesmerizing to watch.
I displayed to the students, and then they had an earlier teacher model that had all these gadgets on them to turn on and off communications with the students. Any of the 200 series Wurlitzer models are all the exact same instrument, just with a few different electronic features and speaker outputs are a little bit different on a few of them. But basically, like 214, 203, 210, they're all the same instrument in here with some different features that apply to them. So right now we have this Wurlitzer open, and if you get down close here, you can see all the mechanical action from the piano, which is just like a boiled down grand piano action, simplified a little bit. It doesn't have a back check or a few other technical things. But yeah, I mean, that's a glimpse of the action kind of wrapping around here, and if you come over the top and look down at it, I don't know how well you'll be able to pick this up, but the part that's vibrating here is the reed, and that's the sound-producing element of the Wurlitzer.
The hammer is hitting the reed is vibrating, and the pickup is picking up the vibrations from the reed.
Yep, and it's perfectly analogous to how an electric guitar works, which is why they're called, you know, electric pianos. They're electromechanical. And the pickup system in this is much different from what you'd find in an electric guitar. It's an electrostatic pickup system. There are electrostatic speakers that a lot of people are aware of. Otherwise, the closest thing to them would be like condenser microphones. So you have a plate in a condenser microphone that's charged up with a voltage and another one that's grounded. And one element sees the vibrations in the other element through capacitance or inductance. And that is exactly what's going on with the Wurlitzer.
Does each key have its own separate pickup, or is it a kind of an array of pickups?
The pickup wraps really tight along with these reeds. So the reed just like fits into its own little tight nook in between the pickup.
Okay.
And then in a second here, I'll grab a reed where you can see the end of it on the form. But there's five or six different reed blanks that are used. There's like, you know, the first bass section and the lower mids and then the mid-range of reeds, and those are all just cut to different lengths and then tuned to pitch.
Matt from the Chicago Electric Piano Company is going to provide us with a demonstration of the Wurly in action to help isolate the sound of the instrument in the context of a familiar classic rock song. And Matt were generous enough to provide details on two other interesting classic keyboards, the Rhodes and the Mellotron. The Rhodes is an electronic piano in the same ilk as the Wurly. However, it has a warmer, more sustaining sound and wider octave range. The Rhodes, conceptually similar to the Wurly, uses traditional wooden piano-style keys, which when pressed, cause a plastic hammer with a rubber tip on its end to strike a metal wire, causing it to vibrate. The resulting sound vibration is then captured by an electronic pickup system. The Wurly's metal part is a reed, whereas the Rhodes uses a tine. The Rhodes and the Wurly paralleled the Coke and Pepsi competitive situation, where each had consumers with preferences, and the Rhodes sold in larger volume.
What instrument do we have here, Matt?
This is a Fender Rhodes suitcase model, which comes with this speaker cabinet underneath here. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like the deluxe model of the two that are popular, the other being the stage model. On these models here, the suitcase model, you have a little bit more on board, vibrato or trem, as we previously discussed, as well as these EQ sliders here, and these are different depending on the year. There weren't this whole rail here and your controls looks different depending on the year, but that's what we have today.
Okay.
So I'm gonna do a little Stevie Wonder classic Rhodes tune.
Metal reeds that are mounted inside of it, that are mounted on one end. The Rhodes also has a vibrating piece that's mounted on one end. And as I flip up the harp here, you can see all of them hanging down. These are the tines that produce the sound, and that's the vibrating part in front of its own pickup system, which is a bunch of electromagnets, very similar to an electric guitar.
So is a tine very similar to a reed? It's just a different shape, or is it fundamentally different?
It's a different shape, and it's mounted to a tone bar, which creates asymmetrical tuning fork design, which gives it a lot more sustain than the Wurlitzer, and so that's why the Rhodes sounds a lot more rich and full compared to the Wurlitzer, which, you know, the notes don't ring out nearly as long or feel as rich and full as the Rhodes. So the tine is this piece of metal here. Now this 88 key model, you can really see them down in the bass section here because they're exposed without a tone bar over the top of them. And here's another one as an example of that tuning fork design. Okay. That's the piece that's vibrating here. It's a swaged piece of metal. Another thing that's swaged is a bicycle spoke. And, you know, basically it's a bicycle spoke vibrating in front of an electromagnet. Front here, you'll see the winding of this spring, and right. That spring is how you tune it. In this case, you'd move the spring forward and back, and that gives you a higher or lower pitch, depending on which way you go.
Gotcha. Okay. A little easier to work with than what you have to do with a reed.
Yes. It's a lot more DIY friendly in the Rhodes than with the Wurlitzer.
The Mellotron is a unique keyboard instrument, which is an early application of sound sampling designed to add orchestral versatility to popular music. The instrument utilizes pre-recorded sounds on magnetic tape, including flutes, violins, and trumpets, to be triggered upon the pressing of the keys. One of the most familiar songs to use it is The Beatles' Strawberry Fields Forever.
On M400, this is kind of like the classic and most produced model. From right around 1970. I'm just taking off the lid here so you can get in and see these tape banks. The tapes are all hanging right down the front of the unit here, and they're held down by these springs that are going to act as rewinding mechanism for it. Play, the tape will travel upwards, play for, you know, right around 8 seconds, and then it needs to rewind, which happens pretty quickly. I want to look at this real quick underneath the keys here. If we flip it up, you can see that the tape is just being pushed down right here underneath the key directly, and then you just have the pinch rollers here, which I really shouldn't get any grease onto. But the pinch rollers are pushing right down here. As we fire this up, you can see the motor is spinning, and the pinch rollers are pushing right down here on this spindle here, and then the tape heads are all behind the tape here, and you physically move them back and forth to select between the three tracks on the tape.
Does this have the barking dog?
This one does not have, we don't have any sound effects. I actually have somewhere a whole bunch of just tape that someone gave me, and it has labeled on there, it says the sound effects loops, but I haven't plugged them in. I mean, it's a lot of work to swap these out. You have to unscrew the tape, and it's just ridiculous.
Right.
So if we're looking right at the side here, you can see that the tape is being pushed down onto the tape head, and then the tape is going to spool right into this bank in the back, and it just kind of spools up. Okay. And then when I release, it all rewinds.
Ah,
and if you watch the front of the tape here, you can also see that it's going to play and then release. And the instrument itself is more than just a sampler. I mean, it is its own instrument in the way that you can control the speed of the tape by controlling the speed of the motor, which is something that you're not going to get with a lot of the digital emulations. But you do get that with Marcus's M4000 Mellotron. But yeah, some of the tone controls as well. It's part of the instrument and what makes it a Mellotron, as opposed to just having samples of the samples.
Okay.
Yeah, and they didn't do the best job sampling everyone and getting them all to play in tune. And with the flutes, you might have a note that has a little bit of vibrato to it, whereas the note next to it doesn't. And they're not going to be like perfectly equal temperament from note to note. They definitely could have spent a lot more time with the recording, but it's also part of what gives it its charm. I worked at UPS all through high school and just had way too much play money for a teenager, and ended up buying a Rhodes and a clavinet before I graduated. And they all need a lot of work, and just stayed up all night long just taking it apart and seeing how everything worked and putting it back together and finding as many online resources as I possibly could and calling up some techs around the country. Some of them are a little bit more helpful than others.
Sure.
And yeah, I graduated college in a pretty bad economy in 2010 and couldn't find a job with my degree. So eventually it spiraled into a full-time gig for me. And it's been great. Most days it feels like playing around and it's fun. You know, it's still stressful, you know, from time to time. But I love working on them, and, you know, nothing feels better than bringing a musical instrument back to life. So.
A mile down the road from the Chicago Electric Piano Company is the Chicago Organ Company. They specialize in sales of vintage, used, and new organs, including vintage and restored Hammond organs and Leslie speakers, as well as specialized parts, repairs, and rentals. Their showroom on Chicago's North Side is the most historical Hammond showroom in the world. And how could it not be, as it is located in the original Hammond organ factory? Paul Chirk carries on the Hammond tradition started by his father, who was an employee of Hammond, and started M&S Organ in the 1970s. Paul began assisting his father when he was only 5 years old. He is one of the most knowledgeable sources of info in the Hammond organ community. The Hammond B3 organ and its partner, the Leslie Speaker Cabinet, have been core instrumentation for popular music for over 50 years. The Hammond organ was even used by Bobby Whitlock on Layla, a song featured in Music and Machines Episode 1.
My name is Paul Turk. I'm the owner of the Chicago Organ Company and carrying on with M&S Organ, which started in 1973 with my dad. He was actually one of the employees of Hammond Organ Company back in the day. The building we're in is actually 4200 West Diversity. For anyone in the Hammond community knows, it's a really historical place. This is actually one of the few rooms that hasn't been changed. It's the original meeting room. They used to hold a lot of meetings. The only thing I did change was the stage. We wrapped it in barnwood, but it's got pretty much the original flooring, the original paneling, some of the original lighting. I mean, everyone knows a B3. When they say Hammond, they say B3. I do have quite a few pretty rare organs, and I'm going to say Hammondabilia in here. It's wrapped up in a blanket, but it's serial number 25, model 8 is literally serial number 25.
And that's this one right here.
Yep.
And it's so new that it still has, looks like a couple of benches on top of it.
Yeah, we just rolled it in, but it was built in, I believe, 1937, don't quote me on it. It's the earliest organ I've ever owned in our company history, and I'm really excited about it. I've wanted one that was that low of a serial number for a long time.
And you say, when you say serial number 25, that means the very first Hammond organ.
It is literally number 25.
Is the model number?
Model
of the first?
A.
Model A.
So it was Hammond and Ford were really good friends, so he started with letters as well. Well, there's going to be less than 50 in existence that are like that.
And this is 25.
This is number 25.
And so is it true that then all Hammond organs, I know the B3 has drawbars. Do all Hammond organs have the drawbars, or is it?
No, because there was a chord organ that did not have drawbars, it had push buttons, which actually I have a prototype organ that's a chord organ / M3. So this is the only one that I know of in existence. This was actually a prototype, never left the factory. So it had the chord organ buttons with the push buttons, and then it had the drawbars, which was an add-on, so they took an M3 and a chord organ and kind of combined it. It actually does work.
Wow. And you said, when you say it never left the factory, you mean it never left this building because it was made here?
It left here and it ended up in someone's private collection. And then I got it from that person's collection when they passed away and then it came back here. But it actually was built in this building. And it never went past prototype stage, I guess is really a better way of saying it.
Sure. I understand.
So there's that. I have a Hammond Player BA.
And now, can you tell me a little bit about this one? I see a roll in the middle, so
yeah,
that must indicate something.
Aeolian and Hammond got together and made the Hammond Player organ, which was the Model BA. I believe there was less than 1,000 made, I believe right around there. This came out of a private collection as well from a gentleman that was really well-known out of New York named Sal Lazzarelli. And I was fortunate enough to get this out of his collection kind of put it on display for everyone to enjoy.
Can you tell me about this particular one?
Sure. So this kind of ended up with a friend of mine that didn't realize what it was. Then we looked up the history of it because it had an auction number, because it's actually, it's set up for 230 volts and 50 cycles. So it's from Europe. So we're trying to figure out, okay, how did it come to the U.S.? Well, upon a little research, we found an auction. It was actually Gary Moore's C3 that he toured with in Europe, and Gary Moore was with Thin Lizzy.
Okay, great.
So I did a little horse trading with my friend because he wanted something, and I got the organ back here.
Nice to have in the collection.
Yeah, so just a cool piece. I honestly think what really made the B3 stay in the music world predominantly has definitely been the church world. The gospel world has just done so much with it. And then the rock and roll, and then now like all the country songs. And it's kind of that mysterious instrument that everyone hears in the background but doesn't know what it is. They think they do, but they really can't put their finger on it. And it's in so many songs and so much music today, even still, and people just get it, but don't understand what it came from or where it originated. I mean, it's even like the Leslie speaker, the Beatles played it all the time. While My Guitar Gently Weeps was through a Leslie speaker, and people don't understand the effect. Pink Floyd was reverb with a Leslie, and they mic'd the piano when it came through the Leslie. I mean, it's just kind of made its imprint on so much music and different genres all over. I mean, it's been just a staple for decades.
And what is the relationship between the Leslie speaker and the Hammond organ? Did they originate together, or did they end up coming together? Or how?
The Hammond and Leslie did not get along very well. They were two different companies for the longest time. I caught a lot of flack when I put serial number plates in the floor of the store right where you're standing, and it says Leslie because this is the Hammond building. Did the floor shake when you did that?
Blasphemy.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, it's just, they go together. For me to sell a Hammond organ without a Leslie is only because it's not in their budget. It's not because they don't want it. I sell probably 300 organs. I have one person go, I just want a tone cabinet. And it's like, no, I want a Leslie. Okay. I heard the relationship got better very later on, but I mean, just to show you how much Hammond didn't want a Leslie with his organ because he felt it corrupted it, you had to buy a Hammond organ with a tone cabinet. The only way you got a Leslie is if you bought it and paid extra, but you had to buy the tone cabinet. So that was his ploy. Now the company was bought by Suzuki Music, so it's Hammond and Leslie Suzuki. They kind of go hand in hand. I don't know how else to even say it.
And for someone who's not familiar with it and wants to understand it a little better, the organ sound, but the Leslie speaker cabinet provides kind of a spinning, whirling sound, right?
Right. So it's kind of like, how do I say it? It's kind of like if you talk behind a fan, it gives you that choppy sound. The only difference is when you talk to a fan, it's actually interrupting the sound. The Leslie takes and throws the sound around. So it's kind of like like when you hear a train go by and you hear go, it's the same thing, so it kind of has that rotary effect to it. And you know, a lot of people have tried to emulate it, and don't get me wrong, they got close, but if you really have a good ear, you can hear the difference. It's just the depth that it projects when as it rotates, it's just different. It's just like it almost has a mechanical sound to it. And like I said, I've heard a lot of things get really, really close, and I had people go, oh man, can you hear this Leslie? I'm like, it's not a Leslie. But there's just certain characteristics that if you're attuned to it, you can hear it.
But it's a peanut butter and jelly situation.
Oh,
just
yeah.
Two things that have just gone well together. That...
Yeah, it's kind of like having, without having the Leslie, it's like you have the PB&J, but you don't have the bread. It kind of doesn't work.
Right.
And this is the tone generator out of a B3, and this is where all the tone wheels would live. So this turns.
The tone wheels are the spinning sound.
Yep. We saw these little orange pieces are a tone wheel. And there's a pickup coil at the end of it. So the more teeth on the tone wheel, the higher the pitch the sound. Because actually as it's turning, it's creating like a frequency wave. And the tighter the pattern, the faster the wave. So it's the same thing. So obviously the ones that have the widest grooves are the lowest frequencies. But these just turn, the pickup coils pick them up, it goes through a filtering circuit, and then it gets all divided and mixed and put into different notes on the organ. You can blend and shade those. How Hammond actually kind of was, because he used to build clocks, and he used to have a synchronous motor which kept the clock in time at exactly, because it ran on 60 cycles. So it's perfectly in time for 60 cycles.
Okay.
60 seconds.
Sure.
And that's actually how he developed the tone generator, because it uses a synchronous motor to keep it in frequency so it doesn't ever lose tune.
Okay, interesting.
So that's kind of how that all kind of fell into place, and then the rest of it was kind of history.
And what are the years that are involved with the kind of the first organ?
So the first tone wheel organ was built, I believe, in like 1937, which would have been like this one. This was literally one of the first ones. The last one being built in 1975.
Okay.
So about 40 years almost.
Sure.
Continuing southward for 3 miles, we landed at Joyride Studio. Owner Blaze Barton has been a fixture in the Chicago recording scene for over 35 years. As a studio owner, recording engineer, pivotal influence at the Engineering and Recording Society of Chicago, known as EARS, software developer, as well as for his most in-demand specialization, audio mastering. He is a member of the Recording Academy and was nominated for 4 Grammys, including 1 award. He has recorded a wide array of independent and major label artists, from Bob Dylan to Buddy Guy and Liz Phair, including an extensive list of blues artists in addition to Buddy Guy, including Coco Taylor, Junior Wells, and Pinetop Perkins. Joyride is the premier blues studio in Chicago. Blaze will discuss the mastering process, but first, to continue the theme of keyboard-oriented instrumentation, Blaze will give us an overview of his Steinway piano and how he optimizes technology to capture the best audio output possible.
I'm Blaze Barton. I run a studio here in Chicago called Joyride Studio. We've been here for 18 years. And we specialize in making records for independent record labels, local musicians, some major record labels.
So this is our studio piano. This is a 1906 Steinway Model O. It's a 6-foot grand, records wonderfully, especially in this room right here. We discovered that by taking the lid off of the piano and putting in this smaller, tighter room, we get the best piano sound. So we figured out like a really good arrangement to put the microphones over the piano in this setup. You know, there's a million ways to record piano. I've seen classical guys like literally they'll put the microphone right up here against like the outside of the piano because they don't want the brilliance of the attack from the hammers hitting the strings. But a lot of times in a recording studio where you have a piano like that's in a band ensemble, the piano has to cut through. It has to have some attack.
And so what you would record, what you'd do normally for a classical recording, you wouldn't necessarily do for like a rock band or a rock song that has piano. So we use these are AKG 451s. These are classic vintage microphones. They're made in Austria. And we put them directly over the hammer line to get the brilliance and the attack from the strings. But in addition to that, we also have a Royer SF24, which is a stereo ribbon microphone. But this microphone is designed to be a high output ribbon mic, and we put that directly over the middle of the soundboard, where all the warmth and the bottom and the, you know, just the magic of the piano comes from. And so when we go to mix the sound from the piano, we mix a little bit of this and a little bit of that. We find a good balance between the two, so you get the brilliance and the attack, but you also get like some of the warmth and the bottom. Usually take about half an hour to knock this piano down and move it in the other room. We don't do that anymore. This piano lives in this room because it just sounds so good. Sounds wonderful. My analogy for mastering is putting the sparkle in the finish of like a car paint job, for example. Let's start here. So for example, so in mastering, what we're starting with, in most cases, not every case, but in most cases, we're starting with the actual stereo mix that comes from the mixing session, which is where you combine all the tracks together and aesthetically pan out the instruments and make a nice stereo image and get the vocals loud enough where you can hear them over the drums and the bass and the guitar and the keyboards or whatever instruments you're dealing with. So what you basically end up with then is a mix, a stereo mix. And that's what this is right here. There's your left channel and there's your right channel. The idea of mastering is to make this sound even better. That's the idea. That's the ultimate goal of mastering. And my favorite quote from Bob Ludwig, who I mentioned earlier, I got to interview at one of these ERAS meetings, is like his mantra, which should be the mantra of every mastering engineer, is do no harm. Do no harm. Make it better. If what you're doing is making the mix not sound better, then you're not doing a good job.
So it's like the Hippocratic Oath of audio engineers.
Yes. Or mastering engineers. So this is just a waveform image of what the sound looks like. This is the same as this after mastering. Now you notice these little sound sausages are way bigger. So this is where it started. This is where it ended up. And part of what this is turning the volume way up on the original mix so that it sounds loud and pops out of the speakers and is competitive with other modern recordings that are properly mastered. And so the process to get from here to here is what mastering is about. It's not just about volume. If I can, so my mastering setup is kind of an analog digital hybrid. You know, like everything else in recording and making records, there's no right or wrong way to do this. It's just your way, like what works for you. So this is what works for me. And that I'm a big believer in iZotope's products. And this is one of the modules that they make, which is an EQ. An EQ is basically like the treble and the bass on your stereo, except you have a lot more options. Instead of just treble and bass, you also have all these other points in here, mid-range and so forth. And while you're mastering a record, maybe no two songs sound quite the same. The idea is to kind of glue everything together and make it sound like it's part of the same project. And not just volume. You don't want to hear the first song come off really loud and then the second song comes on and it's really quiet and you feel like you want to go and turn the volume up. You want not only the volume to be consistent for the whole record, but also the tone, and the tone is the EQ. And so you notice, for example, this is the EQ curve that I came up with just using my ears, listening to this mix. I didn't mix this song, which is very common. People will bring mixes, you know, recordings done elsewhere and have me master them. And another tool that I use besides EQ is a stereo imaging. And what this does, what this tool does, is actually takes the stereo mix you have and actually spreads out the stereo image, actually makes it wider. It kind of wraps the listener inside of the mix itself. And let me see if I can give you an example here.
Maybe time to empathize with experiences of a hindrance.
So this particular tool gives you the ability to actually widen the mix in different frequency spectrums. So this frequency spectrum applies to here, this one here, this one here. I like to do it uniformly. I just like to kind of widen the stereo image just a little bit, just a little bit. And one of the reason I said that I use a hybrid version of mastering is I actually go outboard. This is so far we're talking about working within the digital realm inside the computer. I will actually patch outside and use this vintage Neve compressor from an 8000 series board. It's literally the mix bus compressor. The compressor kind of both limits the loudest louds, but also makes the softest softs louder. So you have a more narrow dynamic range. In other words, you're able to fit a lot more sound into the stereo master than without using the compressor. A lot of people are anti-compression, but believe it or not, some of your favorite records have a lot of compression on them. And the idea is to do it so you don't notice the compression, because there are negative artifacts of compression, and that's bad compression. You don't want to compress things badly. So now I'm going to pop into the chain. So the chain.
When you say in the chain?
Yeah, the chain is the sound goes in and goes through each of these processes, and one of them is the EQ I discussed earlier. This is the equalization. You can see up here in the higher frequencies around 16,000 hertz, which is towards the upper limit of where human beings can hear sound. But it's also where that sugar is, like where the sparkle that I was talking about, the sparkle and the finish, that's where some of that sparkle is. It's like sugar to your ears. And down here around 250 hertz is where some of the nice warm stuff that kind of hits you in the chest a little bit. Down here in the low bass, this particular master didn't need very much because it had plenty of low end. But also I like to emphasize some of the guitars and vocals are up here somewhere around 2800 hertz, 2100 hertz. This is where the instruments have a lot of presence. And so each of these basic frequencies do certain things, and no two masters are the same, no two mixes are the same, and so you really have to use your ears to figure out where it is that you're going to emphasize or de-emphasize. De-emphasizing would be the opposite of boosting. For example, if something was way too boomy around 200 hertz, then we typically would pull out or suck out some of those frequencies. Again, it could be like the listening environment that the mixer was working in. Maybe the speakers are different than mine. I like to think that my speakers are perfect and what I'm hearing is perfect. And generally it seems to translate when I take the mix or play it in my car or play it at home on a boombox or whatnot. If it sounds like it sounded in here, I'm pretty certain that it's going to work on pretty much everything. So,
and that's just over time of optimizing things and iterations of...
Absolutely. You know. And of course, a lot of experimentation and just... I mean, there's no empirical way to describe what mastering is. A lot of it is literally using your ears. You can stare at meters. You can look at frequency meters. They're not going to tell you what's actually happening. You have to use your ears. Beautiful things about this Rupert Neve design compressor is that in order to translate into the world, these boxes, like many of Neve's inventions, have what's called a transformer. It's an input audio transformer and an output audio transformer. And those are meant to match the internal electronics of the box to the actual, how shall I say, the, literally it's the impedance of external devices. But one of the wonderful things about these transformers that were used in this box, as well as many of other Rupert Neve's inventions, is that they color the sound in a very flattering way. Which is really kind of the magic of a lot of Rupert Neve's inventions, is they impart a color or a sound onto what you're working with in a very flattering way, both going into the box and coming out of the box. And especially when we're talking about songs that are made today, like this one, which was almost entirely made in the box. In other words, this song was composed in a computer. It's a digital recording. Pieces like this really warm up the digital aspect of a digital recording. They take the digital away and they make it sound much more warm and friendly to listen to. So go through the EQ, and another aspect I'd like to talk about, but finishing up on the Neve, the signal literally goes out of the digital realm into analog, converted from digital to analog, through the patch bay, into the Neve. From the Neve goes back into the digital realm. So there's a conversion process. And a lot of people might say, well, you're losing a generation or you're losing audio quality there, but I disagree. I think the advantage and the benefit that you get from passing through this magical box makes a huge difference. There's a lot of sitting around as an intern or a second or assistant engineer where you're just hours and hours of just sitting there. Sometimes, especially if you're an intern, you're not getting paid. You got to stick in there. You got to stick with it. There's way fewer opportunities today for young people to get their foot in the door and work in a recording studio, mainly because a lot of recording studios have gone away. You know, the studios that are staying in business nowadays are tight, compact, low overhead, few employee, like what I have here. This is why I've been here for 18 years. We wrote it out through 2008. We're writing out through this COVID crisis. But my point being, like, if you really want to do this job, you got to stick in there. You got to stick with it. Go research the gear. Go research, learn Pro Tools, like learn it inside and out. Get a copy of Pro Tools and learn it inside and out. Or Logic, if that's your thing. Logic is amazing. But that's my message to young people. Like, stick it out and really stick in there. And one day, a door is going to open for you. And that door is going to offer you the opportunity to walk in and do what it is that you want to do. No one's going to hand this stuff to you. No one.
If you enjoyed our segments on classic keyboards and like to get more information, we recommend getting the book Classic Keys by Alan Lenoff and David Robertson. It provides in-depth profiles on a variety of keyboards used in popular music over the last century, and Max Brink is one of the contributors. That's it for this episode of Music and Machines. Thanks for watching, and please continue to join us in our exploration of music and the machines that help make and shape it.